morning. Today I'm going to speak about what we have done in the past 6 months with ntop NG, where NG stands for next generation. And I will start with a short introduction to who we are, to what we believe is important to do in network monitoring, contrary to, I think, many tools that you are using or what I think I've seen on the program. We are focusing on traffic monitoring. So we look at the packets, we look at what people are doing, what data is exchanged, more than what a certain system is doing. So if the CPU is too high, if the database is fast enough, and so on. So we look only at the network traffic. So you give us an Ethernet cable or a Wi-Fi connection, and we show you what is happening. This is the idea. And the idea is that you can take this data and integrate it into your network monitoring solution. So where you have the system, the devices, and the traffic. I will explain you how we decide to move from the old, let's say, the legacy ntop that started to develop in 1998 to the new one and why. I will explain you the architecture and what you can do with the new ntop and how you can use it. And then some features that you can do with ntop NG and where we are planning to go. But before annoying you with a lot of discussions, I want to tell you that the goal is to show you this. So this is the new ntop, this is the new dashboard. As you can see, it is a tool developed for the web. It is HTML5. It is dynamic. So as you can see, this is updated every second. It is real time. It is not near real time. It is real time, just as the delay of the browser for downloading the data. It is graphical. It is everything is HTML5. You can click and you can see what is happening. So this is the goal. And this is what is happening at the moment here on this network through the WLAN. And there is not much to see because it is mostly traffic that is broadcasted. So your PCs are doing spontaneously, let's say. So this is the goal today, okay? I will go here in, let's say, half an hour, but I want to explain you the idea that brought me to this application. So you have to wait half an hour, but I will go there. So let's start from a short introduction of ntop. This is the first time I'm here, so you probably want to know a little bit more about the background. So ntop is a small Italian company. We are 5 people. We are based in Italy. We have some colleagues in the US, but we are mostly an Italian company. So we started in 1998 with ntop, the first application that is also giving the name to our domain name and to whatever we do. Why ntop? Because N stands for network, and ntop is the top tool that you see on the PC, so the standard top. And at that time we decided, actually I decided, because I started this myself, to give, first of all to me, and then to the rest of the people, a tool that was enabling me to see what was happening on the network in real time, okay? You know that there is SNMP, there are many other tools, but the problem with those tools is that they are not simple to use. Actually, you need a tool for using SNMP. So you need another thing for using SNMP. Whereas people are usually used to something simpler. At that time, the shell was the main thing. So I thought that top was a good idea to show graphically what was happening in the move with the cursor interface in the screen. But at the same time, it was the beginning of the web. So I tried to put a web interface into it. So ntop was an application that was telling me the top users of something, just to understand if there is a bottleneck, who is responsible for that. This was the idea. And then over the years, we moved to many other topics just for ntop. Why this? Because traffic monitoring today requires high speed. 1 gigabit connections are standard on most laptops, on most devices. And 10 gigabit is more or less cheap today. So a 10 gigabit port today costs about €300. So it's not that expensive anymore. And we are moving towards 40 gigabit. So 10 gigabit, let's say, is the standard. It's a speed we must achieve with the PCs we have today. And another problem that is important, we want to accelerate deep packet inspection. So we want to look inside the packet, because in 1998, when you see port 25 is email, port 80 is HTTP, everything was very simple. Today, it is not so simple anymore, because especially protocols such as HTTP are used by many applications. So HTTP doesn't mean anything to me anymore. It is Dropbox, it is YouTube, it is something else, is Skype over HTTP because I'm trying to escape the firewall rules, something like that. Also, with our software, we accelerate IDS and IPS. So if you're familiar with Snort or Suricata, these are the things we are doing. So our open source software that accelerates packet capture is used not only by ntop, but is also used to accelerate those tools towards 10 gigabit. And of course, our software has been integrated in many tools. So first of all, this one is the NBox that we are doing together with the Virtual Phoenix. You will see a presentation later this morning. This is a Cisco device that included the original NTOP, so not the one I'm showing today. This one is an SFP plus, so it's one of the things that you put in your switch here that converts from optical to electrical, and inside this. This is a thing we have done with Agilent and then later JDSU. You have a probe. So it means that this tiny thing where you connect your fiber on is able to monitor your traffic. Or it's also able to emit the traffic. So you can have a ping or a source of traffic into your switch. And this is a Cisco switch 4948 that contains a NetFlow Lite. And that is something we have developed with Cisco. Everything you see here is open source. Okay, so just to give you the background, that ntop is not just the component, but it's one of the many components we have. Okay, let's start from my view, my personal view of network monitoring. Years ago, in the 90s, when I started to play in this field, the focus was on standard, because this was the year of the big blue. So IBM, HP, you know, there are several vendors. And you had to adopt one or the other, or many times most of them. So the idea was to create a standard. So there was HP OpenView that was the market dominator, and many other standards such as Harmon. This was a good beginning in the sense that we moved off proprietary solutions towards a more standardized view of the internet, but unfortunately, it was vendor-driven. So mostly like today, but this was a bit more extreme. So basically, if somebody was doing a certain thing, you had to adopt it because you were forced to adopt it because most of those tools were created by these companies. So in the sense, it was complicated, it was very expensive, it was not internet-oriented, it was vendor-oriented. So you cannot simply plug in a new device. You had to buy a device from one of those leading companies in order to be able to monitor them. So this was not good. So we tried to fill this lack, creating a simple monitoring application that was talking with those devices, but that was not necessary integrating into those devices. Because the problem is that we wanted to create something open source, or something cheap. Okay, it was not possible for us to be bound to those devices without paying a fee, and this was not something that we liked. So we created the ntop. And today, the market is still partially driven by hardware manufacturer, and as you can see, if you look at products, you will see that what you can do is mostly limited by what the hardware manufacturers are deciding that you can do. Okay. Just to give you an idea, there are products like Cisco Telepresence or VoIP devices that can be monitored only if you buy from the vendor the monitoring tool, and this is not what we want. So we wanted to create a tool that was not that was independent from those people. We wanted to create something that was free. You can install it, you can use it, you can customize. But we don't want to be able to do an evolution only when they decide it is time to do the next step. So we wanted to decide that, and I will show you later on what is the idea. So the goal of ntop is to provide cheap and tools that are not evolving, okay, based on the evolution of the supplier. A good example, I think, is SNMP. SNMP is still the same thing since the 1990s. You will see monitoring a new network interface. You will ping this interface through SNMP every 5 minutes or 1 minute or whatever you want. you can even read data every second, but you will see that most of the times, especially if you go up in the market with the high-end devices, that every 5 seconds you see a new value, because most of the time, even if you pull the counter every half a second, the counter will be always the same, just because the hardware works in a certain way. So we wanted to change that. With SNMP, you can still see, you know, a port, how much traffic is doing, but nothing more than that. You cannot inspect traffic. You cannot wait for these guys to provide you something new. It's, I think, 4 years they are talking about the packet inspection, just to understand the protocol. But what these guys at the IETF are doing, they are talking about dividing IPv4 from IPv6, you know, ping from ICMP generic, something like that. That people don't need that. People today have Dropbox, for instance. Maybe tomorrow they will have something else, but tomorrow means really tomorrow, okay, or the next month. And we must be able to create something on the fly. We cannot wait, these people. Here in Germany, I'm sure you have a cable television or you have something from Deutsche Telekom that we don't have in Italy. And you must be free to extend it for supporting this type of protocols. It's not that you have to wait the IETF or Cisco or Juniper to wait until they update their systems, because maybe they don't care about this country. Maybe they just care about the US. They care about Netflix that you don't have. So this is the base idea around this this thing. And for traffic monitoring also, it is important for us to create something that is running on every PC. You're seeing that today I've shown you ntopng on this Macintosh. It's running here, it's running Windows, it is running on small devices. It's basically running everywhere on a platform that is adequate enough to compile C++ code. This is the thing. But we also want to exploit high-end machines, because if we want to go at 10 gigabit or beyond 10 gigabit, we cannot expect to use a cluster of devices. I've seen that before it has been announced at the conference on large data, big data. These are standard things today. They're nice. But these guys are forcing you to have a cluster of machines, many devices that are sharing the load, that are increasing the complexity. So we want to scale, first of all, on the single node. Once this node has been exploited, then we'll probably increase the number of nodes. But with one machine, we want to monitor 20 gigabit, at least, in the modern system. So this is the idea. So we want to be able to create something that is able to accept the fact that machines are multi-node, are multi-core, and we want to exploit those devices without forcing you to buy very expensive hardware stuff. And we don't want to be vendor locked. So this is the idea. And another point is that people today are using virtual machines. And virtual machines are more and more common. And being then common, it means that we cannot ignore them. We cannot simply say, okay, the cloud is another story. The cloud is the same problem, just relocated in a data center that does not belong to us. So we must be able to monitor both standard system that we have on our desk, and also our services that are running on a data center that is not physically next to us. So it is important to do that. And the cloud service cannot be monitored with a simple ping, because you cannot monitor Dropbox, because Dropbox is a service you are using, but is not a service that you provide. And also the services are physically located in many places, and the fact that you access one service from here, from Nuremberg, doesn't mean that the same IP address is used by another device in Munich. So this is the thing. So we must look at the traffic, and we must understand what is happening. And we also want to give visibility of packet encapsulation, especially on mobile networks or on VPNs, because there are many companies that are physically probably located here in Germany, but there are branches everywhere. So the VPN is becoming a standard way of connecting remote sites to you. And we have to look at those packets too. So we cannot simply say we care about Ethernet only, so I don't care about remote connections. So we have to look at them simply like the traffic on virtual machines. And of course, so we have, at least my view, we don't have to ignore Windows, because Windows is an important thing. Maybe Windows does not cope with open source monitoring, but doesn't matter. It's a very popular platform that I think we need support. So, some history. Ntop, the original Ntop was this. It started in 1998, it was a C-based application. The GUI was like this, more or less. So you see standard table, so HTML, simple HTML, no Ajax, no HTML5, nothing. It was a web interface able to report information. Whenever you want to see something new, you refresh the screen. Okay, this was the standard at the time. It is available on the Windows and Unix, and it was GPL. The architecture was designed to be simple enough to run also on phones, so not so smartphones. This was a WAP interface, as you can see. And the idea was to be able to have a layer system where you have at the bottom the packet sniffer that captured packets. This today is no longer a big problem, but on those days it was a big problem because there were several different interfaces and Ethernet was just one of those. Whereas today Ethernet and Ethernet-like devices like Wi-Fi are basically the only devices. So there was a component for parsing traffic. Another one was applying certain rules to the traffic just to see if the traffic was good or bad. And there are some plugins that allow you to speak with SNMP, with NetFlow, so to integrate some flow from Inmon S-Flow or Cisco NetFlow, store data into round-robin database, and of course to access this through HTTP. So this was the original idea. This started in 1988, as you can see. We are maintaining this for almost 10 years, for more than 10 years, and then at some point we decided that it was time for something new. Why? First of all, because the design was LAN-oriented. So at that time, the internet was providing very little data. So most of the traffic was inside the LAN. So most of the traffic was from PC to PC. Whereas today, you will see some traffic being exchanged by machines, but the interest is to see what is happening from the outside world to us, where internet does not mean the internet. It maybe means, you know, from your side to another side. So I don't really care, although it is important and it is supported still, what your PC next to me is doing, if it's sending a packet or not. But the idea is to understand the main traffic sources. The GUI is new, so HTML5. It is not written in C like it used to be, but it's scriptable, so you can modify it with a script. And the code was not simply good, because after 15 years, you can imagine that it was really spaghetti code, because you know, you change this today, this tomorrow, and then at the end, it's a total mess. So we decided that it was time to start over. So the new ntop has a clean separation between the monitoring system and the visualization system. I think, unfortunately, this is still a problem today for many tools, because sometimes most of them are really integrated. I want to give you an example. Ntop is using Redis, that it's a great in-memory database. And unfortunately, Redis is one system that is monolithic. Okay, just to give you an example. It is not possible to embed into your application. Everything is self-contained. Whereas here, we have decided to divide this in two pieces. So on one hand, you will have the ntop engine that collects networking data and you know, keeps this data in memory and analyzes it. And then you have the web GUI. The web GUI I've shown you before. This is the web GUI. But this web GUI is optional. So it's a way to visualize the data. It might be that you don't care about this web GUI at all, because you want to use ntopng as a source of data for your Nagios or iSinga or Open Web MS or whatever. So it's just a way to receiving data through a web-based protocol, and that's it. Maybe you don't want to show this, okay? Because probably NETWAYS wants to integrate ntopng into their monitoring system, and they don't like this look and feel. They have their own look and feel. So it's a source of data. You have to look at this application like a way to provide you monitoring information in a way so that your application can read it. If you want to use this web GUI, fine, but it is not compulsory. So the division, the boundary between monitoring and visualization is very clean, okay? This is just an add-on. It is part of the application. Most of the people will use it, but it is important it's not there. And the main problem of SNMP of those tools is that you know, they force you to be 100% into that system. And this is something that we decided it was not the case with our application. So the architecture is divided in several layers. At the bottom, you see packet capture. PFRing is our technology for accelerating packet capture at 1 and 10 gigabit, and that allows us to be efficient here at this level. This is the Linux kernel. So from here down is the Linux kernel. It is not compulsory to use PFRing because I've shown you macOS, or we show you other devices that are not Linux-based. So if it's present, it's faster. Otherwise, we'll use the platform support provided for packet capture. Then we have here the monitoring engine that is based on NDPI. That is a deep packet inspection library we developed, and I will talk about this later. We are talking with a data cache called Redis, where we store, this is a cache, it's not a database, so we store temporary data on it just to divide the data from the engine. And then we have the ability to present you data where the web interface is written in Lua. Lua, I don't know if you're familiar with it, it's a very efficient language. It's very small, it's easy to embed. It is similar to Python, to Perl in a way, so it's scriptable. But it's much, much more efficient than it is using very little memory. It's multi-threaded, it's very good. I will talk about that later. So, PFRing, that is at the bottom of our system, allows you to capture packet at high speed through this new network kernel module called PFRing, where ring stands for a memory buffer, a circular memory buffer, where packets are copied. And here, these packets are read in user space through memory map. So it is very efficient to move packet up. Again, this is an optional component. If you have it, it is faster. If you don't have it, we'll use the standard packet capture system you have on your network. Over the year, so this started in 2004 for 1 gigabit, and in 2010 for 10 gigabit, we have developed something called DNA, Direct NIC Access, that allows us to read packets from a network device, not polling them like Linux is doing with NAPI. When you do a top on Linux, you will see Ksoft IRQ, that it's a kernel thread that is reading packets, but simply reading them either through an FPGA, if your card is an FPGA, or the network packet adapter that you have. So it means, in a nutshell, that with your Core 2 Duo of 2007, you can send and receive data at 10 gigabit. Okay, so you can imagine what you can do with the modern machines. So this is important because you have your own traffic generator. It's important because you have very fast and efficient packet capture without buying any expensive hardware. This is a standard PC that you buy at MediaMarkt, and that's it. It's working. And it means that your application can spend the CPU cycles to analyze data, not to capture packet from the wire. So this is the feature that is available only on Linux, because PFRing is a Linux kernel module, but it gives you the ability to go fast without spending any money, because the standard Linux is enough and a standard PC is enough. So let's talk about the monitoring engine. The monitoring engine of ntopng is coded in C++. The idea was to create something that was divided in classes. Every class is doing something specific. So if you are a programmer, you can put your hands on it very easily, because you can look at one file. So I don't know, host.c++. So this is for host, flow.c++, this is the flow. Something very, very simple. If you want, you can modify that. Each flow is a set of packets with the same sextuple. What is the sextuple? IP source, IP destination, port source, port destination, protocol, and VLAN, if you have it. So whenever we receive a packet, this packet is classified in a flow, and flow is the main unit. Each flow will have an host source and an host destination, and of course, a network interface. Packets are inspected with a library that is doing DPI. DPI means deep packet inspection, so it means that you go inside the packet payload, so not just on the packet header, and you look at the packet content. In a way, this is not nice, because you are looking at the traffic that probably that goes beyond what you should do. But on the other hand, here, we are not extracting user or passwords. We are just looking at the packet because we want to learn about the traffic that is flowing. I want to know if this is Dropbox, or I want to know if this is YouTube, or I want to know if this is HTTP, because you are looking at an online magazine. We don't want to spy people. This is very important. anyway, this is open source, so you have the source code, so you can inspect it. And we want to use this for understanding more about your traffic. We want to extract information. So just to give you an idea here. So these are, for instance, DNS names that you see. So my PC is sending some traffic, and you see that these are the domain names I'm trying to access, I'm trying to resolve, because this is DNS. Or if you are here, you will see the protocol. So this is the real protocol. So it means that here you are trying to not say this port, what is this? I know exactly what is that. Regardless of the port, regardless of the application that is generating a certain traffic, okay? So this is important. So deep packet inspection is not for spying people, but for giving you a breakdown of the traffic, so to understand what is happening on your network. So the goal, is to create a pie chart like that. Okay, there is not much to see because I'm just looking at the broadcast traffic again. And so my PC, probably you will have more luck in your system. But I want to understand what is really going on. I don't want to say this Dropbox in reality is HTTP. I want to say this is Dropbox because on my PC, my Dropbox friend is trying to connect to the internet. Is not lucky, but this is the idea. Okay, so deep packet inspection is not for extracting data, it's just for looking at what your traffic is and to read important information such as, for instance, the operating system, read out from HTTP traffic, for instance. So this is the thing. And the DPI is important to characterize your traffic because you see here, today we have a lot of traffic that is unknown. It is unknown because it's mostly broadcast traffic, so sometimes somebody sends a packet and I don't know what is that. It's trying to discover the device. So it's important to say people, in my network, this is what is happening. So this is the goal behind DPI. And like I said, the information is clustered through device, flow, host, and higher level aggregation. Everything in ntopng is put in memory. So you will see that the information is kept in memory. And of course, the memory exhausts after a while. So whenever a host or a flow is not active for some time, ntopng is purging this data from memory and removing it. This means that if you have a host that is doing a traffic now, okay, and then for 1 minute doesn't, or 2 minutes or 3 minutes doesn't do anything, this host disappears from memory. This was a main concern for existing ntop users because some of them didn't like this. Okay, they like the fact that ntopng you know, can keep things in memory, but they didn't like the fact that at some point a certain host was disappearing from memory. So in the new ntopng, we have fixed this memory, and this is the reason why we're using the Redis cache. So the Redis cache is a place where we conserve the information about hosts that are no longer active, so this is one of the goals, it's not the only one, so that you can retrieve the host information that are no longer active, and you can see them resume from where you have been. So this is the idea. Eh? So in memory, you keep just the most recent information, then at some point, you drop data. Everything is available in JSON format. So everything here is web-oriented. So if you have an external application, like I've said, you can read traffic information from ntop in JSON. So you issue an HTTP request, so with the user and password, and you read this data in JSON, and you can visualize it everywhere. Again, or you can read data from ntop and use it for your own monitoring and NETWAYS-based things. Okay, this is very important. Packet processing is very short. So we capture the packet, pfring or Linux or libpickup. We decode the packet. If it's IPv4 or IPv6, we try to divide it into inflows. We increment the statistics. We, of course, update the source and destination host. And we use deep packet inspection for analyzing the packet that is flowing. So for UDP, we don't need more than two packets, so request or response to analyze the protocol. For TCP, we wait up to 15 packets, so usually 7 in each direction, because you have the three-way and shaking, maybe at the beginning you don't do much. And then if within 15 packets we have realized that this is the protocol X, you say, This is Dropbox, this is YouTube, this is Skype. If we are not able to identify the traffic, we say this is unknown. We have no idea. Of course, we use Redis as a cache, because if you see the flow at the beginning, you will have very useful information for identifying the traffic. But if you are at the middle of the connection, this is not possible. That is another use of Redis. And then we move to the next packet. So the idea is something very simple. So the packet inspection is something that is necessary today. I want to stress this. Without the packet inspection, we'll see a lot of statistics per port. But today, a port doesn't mean anything. So if you read your traffic and you look at the port or IPs, I think you don't have real visibility, because people are using the IP packet just for carrying traffic. Okay, so protocol like HTTP, hypertext transfer protocol, just to give you a good example, are not for hypertext, so for something you can click on. It's just a protocol. It's a simple protocol that everybody's using. So DPI is really necessary, I think. And we wanted to do this DPI since a very long time, and then we started to look around. In Linux, there is a nice thing like called layer server filter that allows you to put a regular expression that allows you to analyze the packet payload and to say, OK, if it starts with get, uppercase, space, slash, something, so it's probably HTTP. We didn't like it because it was error prone. It was slow because you have to run, you know, regular expressions. And then we started to look at the packet inspection toolkit. But they were not a good idea. First of all, because you have to sign a non-disclosure agreement, so it means that you can use it, but you cannot integrate it into an open source solution. And also because they are very expensive for maintenance, also because it costs not a specific amount of money, let's say 1,000 euro, 10 euro. But usually it is a percentage of your income, your company income. So it means that, let's say, 5% of your income. And I think this is very bad, because the cost is too high and is not acceptable. So I decided to create something new, and something that does not require a vendor support. So you have your own protocol. If you want to add your extra one, just add it. But don't have to call somebody that is forcing you to buy a certain maintenance that is a percentage of your cost. So I started from a library called OpenDPI that was developed here in Germany that was no longer maintained. This was a GPL library. I took the ownership and I extended. So we have added many protocols, even something for business, of course, streaming. So you see things like Citrix or RDP, and of course Skype BitTorrent. So this library today is able to recognize those protocols. And actually, we have created a kernel module, new kernel module, that allows you to block certain protocols. You can say this PC, no Facebook, this other PC, no Viber, something like that. So the idea was to use this information to learn more about your network traffic. This was the important thing. And like I showed you before, so we have reports like this, so where I can show you what is really happening on your network in real time. Is this expensive? Yes, it costs a little bit because we have to look at the packet payload. But if you look at solutions such as DNA, PFRing DNA, you know, capturing a whole packet instead of just a packet tether is not expensive. Okay, but at the end, you will see that the increase in CPU load for NDPI is less, usually less than 5 or at most 10%. So you will not really notice that on a modern PC. And you have a great advantage of understanding what is happening. So we believe that this is a nice cost to pay. And also, it's important to understand that DPI, I believe, it's a requirement today. We cannot really live without it for too long. Redis, like I've said before, it's a cache, where ntopng is storing temporary information such as the configuration of the user. This is more persistent data. So we have the DNS name resolution. So whenever we see a host, we see the numerical IP, we try to convert it to a symbolic IP, or we learn this information from the network. Before here, I've shown you that we have these aggregations. So these name of data are being learned from the DNS. So we have looked at the DNS response, and DPI has decoded the DNS response, has mapped this information to a host. So this is the type of data that we are storing here. So the DNS name resolution is not really compulsory. So it's something that most of the time we learn from the network. Or we have volatile data, such as you know, the some monitoring data, such as the JSON host representation, when we have to save host. It's important that Redis can be configured to be a long-term database, so where we store data for a long time, or a short-term database. So whenever you save one data, you tell Redis how long the data is to be kept stored. Okay, so it's not like MySQL, where when you save the data is there forever. Here you have to say how long it lasts. And depending on the type of data, so for instance, this one has to be persistent, so you say forever. And this time you say, okay, DNS resolution 1 hour. So if after 1 hour nobody has used, just remove it from memory. Another integration that we have done with Redis is something we have called the microcloud. So if you have several applications, here you see ntop and another tool we have developed called mprobe that are putting data into this cloud of Redis system that are a cluster. So Redis allows you to create a cluster. You can read information here whenever you want, but the nice thing is that you can do a subscribe. You can say, please alert me when host X is doing this activity, okay? So this is important because you are moving the problem of monitoring traffic to a totally different problem here. So you will see that these guys are putting data into the cloud, and you will see that a monitoring application can be alerted when something is happening. So without knowing anything about IP, IPv4, DPI, nothing, zero. It's a good way of being triggered. It's a good way of sharing data. Because if ntopng keeps the data inside itself, it's not good. But if it's starting to share this data with other Redis machines, I think this is a very good idea. So this is a sort of semi-persistent cache, where you will see that you know, everybody can contribute to it. Okay, and from the cache, you can read data whenever it's necessary or can be alerted on time simply doing a subscribe. This is a very important information. So a typical uses is that, okay, we store the DNS cache. So if you have multiple location, we don't have to put it into one place, but everybody can go there. We store information about tunnels. This is GTP. It's a protocol used in mobile networks. So it's important because sometimes, okay, today I'm here in Nuremberg, but I'm here. If I go to the city center, I will probably attach to another cell. So I will be roaming in this town. So if I want to have an aggregate view of what my telephone is doing, I'm forced to monitor several different points. And with the microcloud, I can have a general view of this information. I can associate an IP to a username. So next to my flow, I can put Luca instead of my IP. That my IP is a temporary number I have here today. But maybe in 10 minutes, the DHCP will give me another name. So the name is important. Also, we can be triggered on publish and subscribe whenever something is happening. I told you that ntopng has a scriptable web interface. The web interface is written in Lua. It can integrate it, for instance, in other tools like Nagios or OpenNMS based. So the web is nice, fine, but it's not important. The important thing is the engine. The engine provides you data through JSON and HTTP, so you can read data, you can use the data the way you like. This is very important. So the freedom is not just in the source code, but the freedom is also in the way that you use the data for integrating into your existing system. Okay, this is very important. We have two types of scripts. One are the callback, the scripts that are executed periodically. So you have a daily script, hourly script, minute script, or second script. The second script is the one that is drawing the graph and storing data every second. And of course, you have scripts that are used for executing through the web. So this one, for instance, is showing the statistics about the flow. Okay, this is doing, log out. So this is the flow stats. So everything is written in Lua. So whenever you click, a Lua script is executed on multiple of them, and the screen is refreshed. And they are part of the ntopng distribution. So the path here is explaining what a certain script is doing. Ntop defines two classes. So one is the interface, that gives you information about a specific interface. So today I'm monitoring just one device, that is the Wi-Fi. But if you want to, you can monitor multiple links, and each link is defined as an interface. So ETH0, ETH1, whatever. And this gives you information about the flows and the host on the interface. So you can monitor two interfaces simultaneously and have an aggregated view if you want. And then we have the ntop class that gives you general information about the ntop configuration, how it is configured, what ntop is doing. The classes are accessed by Lua, usually in read-only mode. So usually the web GUI is not able to modify the content of ntop, just because you want to read data and display. But in some cases, it's possible to do something more effective. So for instance, if you're looking at an host that is no longer in memory because it's not doing traffic, ntopng shows you on the web, OK, this host is no longer active, but it did send traffic, you know, 10 minutes ago. Do you want to restore it in memory? And you click yes. And Lua tells ntopng to go into Redis, read from the cache, and display the host in memory. OK, so usually the web GUI is reading data, but it's also possible to modify ntop data. We support multi-thread. We have very limited locks, so we can say that the peer interface is lockless. We have very limited locks, so whenever the web GUI is integrating with, so is reading data, sorry, from the engine, but those locks are not per packet, are just whenever the web GUI wants to do a specific action, so it's pretty fast, as you can see from the screen. Just to give you an idea, we have users that are pushing ntopng to monitor 5-6 gigabit of traffic with a four cores machine. So it is pretty efficient. It is multi-threaded, so whenever you click, you don't have to wait like in the old ntop a certain URL to complete, but you can have many of them executing at the same time. And you can see this on the web interface. So whenever you click here, this one calls an AJAX method that returns the host list and so on. So let's now look at ntopng and now how it looks. So let's close the web and let's start again. Sorry, log out. So the first thing you see in ntopng, it's a login. You cannot access it without being logged in. Okay? You can put demo or whatever you want, but you must be logged in. Okay? So whenever you log in into ntopng, you will see this that we call dashboard. Here we see the top flow tokens. So it means the top host activities. I want to read this information with you. As you can see, ntop is looking at the main activities. Okay? So if a host has moved 1 terabyte of data and now is idle, you will not see it here. You will see here the main flow of information that are exchanging data. It is dynamic. Let's look at the way it is represented. So the main host, you know, are represented with a color. Okay? So this is IP and this is the color. The connection here, it means that there is some communication between a certain host and another host. Okay? So let's look at this communication. Okay? So this IP address is talking with this other IP address. And you want to say, okay, but where is the prevalent communication? Is from host A to host B or from host B to host A? So just look at the color here. You will see this is the same color as this is not green. So it means that the main traffic is originated by the host whose color is. So in this case, let's wait a second. So it can refresh. So this is blue. So this is closest to this. So this one means I sent a lot of traffic to the other host. Or in this case, this broadcast host, has received traffic. Has received traffic from the other host. So here the 62 has received traffic from, has sent traffic to the 255. Okay? The smaller is the line, less traffic. The higher is the line, is more traffic. So this is the top flow talkers. This is called something we call the dashboard. As you can see at the bottom of the dashboard, we have something that every second here. and you will see the traffic in real time, so in number of kilobytes per second and packets per second. You will see here the number of hosts you have monitored by ntop and the number of flows you have monitored. Here, since how long ntop is monitoring your traffic. And then there are some menus you can see at the top. So the first menu here allows you to go to the to main activities, but mostly to the dashboard. Here you will see other things related to host. Here you see the list of hosts. You will see the top host. So the top hosts are doing the top activities, those that use your bandwidth most. Here you see aggregation. So a way to aggregate data based on certain criteria. So for instance, you want to see all the hosts that are running macOS X. So this is an example. Or all the hosts that have contacted, I don't know, Dropbox.com. So these are the things. The interaction is when a certain host is talking with another host. What are they exchanging? What is the type of data they are talking to each other? Here the geomap. So you can see how the data is physically shown on the internet. So it's your German PC talking with an American PC, so we'll see a Google map that displays this data. A tree map allows you to see in a standard view, in a small view, what are the most host activities. And here you see the local matrix. So two hosts that belong to your local network, what type of activity are doing. So the number of packets that host A is sending to host B and host B to host A. Then you have the interface view. So the web is limited to one interface at a time, but ntopng is monitoring multiple interfaces at a time, depending on how you start it. So here you can switch the view from one interface to another. And of course, you can manage users. So at the login, when you have seen the user admin, you can decide who is doing what, the privilege. And of course, you can export data through JSON. The web interface I've shown you is dynamic. You will see that, for instance, at the bottom of the screen, what I've shown you, probably here you can read it better, there is a gauge here that is increasing or decreasing based on your traffic. Unfortunately, here today, there is very little traffic, but you can click on it. So if you click on the gauge, you can set the interface speed. Why that? Because if you have, let's say, a 10 megabit internet connection, okay, and your interface is 1 gigabit, you cannot, and ntopng cannot use 1 gigabit, because otherwise it will be always like that. Here you have to put a 10 megabit, so you could see, you know, the gauge, how much traffic is using on your real data. And you will see that next to every counter, there is an arrow that is going up and down. Why this? It tells you not the amount of traffic instantaneously, but also the trend. So it says, okay, this is one is 5.6 kilobytes, but is it increasing or is it decreasing? Or it's equal. So this I think is very important. Let me show you something. So this is, again, I'm sorry, but there is very little traffic here. So you will say that nothing is happening here. So they are static. But if you see traffic for this specific flow, you see now it's increasing because a packet has been sent out. So you can also understand the trend, whether it's stable, it's increasing, or it's really decreasing. And this is next to every counter in ntop. You see, this is increasing, now you see something. Everything is dynamic here, this is increasing, so through JSON. And whatever you see, you can click. So for instance, you can click here on this IP address. Also, the name of application. I told you that NDPI understands 170 protocols, that some of them you can configure. But we only show you those that are available on your network, so that you are not confused by, you know, hundreds of names that you don't know because you have never used. Okay, so this is important. As I showed you before, the main concept is the flow. So in flow, you see what is happening, you see the protocol breakdown, so it means that most of the traffic is sent by this guy to this guy. Of course, this is multicast. You can see here the counters, and you see the application protocol. You can see all the flows, or just those that are related to a specific protocol. So in this case, let's look only at DNS. You'll see only the DNS traffic. Or let's look only at IGP. You will see only IGP traffic. So you can filter on the fly. And whenever I click here, my web GUI is talking with the ntopng running on my machine, and it's reading this data on the fly. And we have a similar view for host. So every host is geolocalized based on GeoIP. So I know where it is, or I try to guess where it is. I know if it's remote or local to my network. So whenever you start ntopng, you have to tell your local network. You can see the autonomous system. And you see this link. So whenever you click on something that will move you outside of ntopng, like in the wiki, you know there is something that indicates that you're leaving a page that is local. And the host monitoring, the host monitoring, let's look at my PC. This is my PC. The host monitoring likes this, so you have seen that there was a spinning icon here. So it means that ntop has not been able, let me try to refresh the page, has not been able to learn the IP address, so it's doing a DNS name resolution, but this is a local IP, so it has failed. So you mean that these activities are done asynchronously. You will see the trends I told you before. You will see that here, this is Intel Mac OS X. This is not something I've written, but it means that ntopng through NDPI has looked at the HTTP traffic, and looked at the user agent, and learned that this was a Mac OS X, and has put it there. This is persistent. As you can see here, there are counters. So up means that they are increasing. And of course, you can download, because everything is like that in ntopng, the representation in JSON of this host. So you can read it from remote as JSON. And this is an interesting map I want to show you. Ntopng has a resolution of 1 second. Everything in ntopng is 1 second resolution. So here, this is the activity map. You see that this host has performed here little activity, more activity, and so on. And clicking on it, you say that this has performed activity for 7 seconds here. Or if you click on a dark green, you see for 51 seconds. So I know every second if a certain host has done a certain activity or not. And this information is stored persistently on disk, is compressed. So as you can see, this bitmap is only 24 bytes. Okay. The idea behind ntopng is like the idea behind Gmail. When I've seen Gmail the first time, I was not interested in the fact that it was free. Many other emails were free. But the nice thing about Gmail that the potential space was infinite. Okay? So this is the idea. One of the main problems of network monitoring is that you have a certain amount of disk space, and everything you do has to be stored on this amount of disk. But unfortunately, the data you're saving on disk is large. So even if you have 1 terabyte of data, you will exhaust it in 6 months, 1 year. Now I want to do the same, like Gmail. If we store data, and 1 day of data like this occupies 24 bytes, you know that we 1 terabyte of data that now costs less than €100, you can store more or less forever. So this is the same idea. With ntopng, I want to move this problem from a standard disk space problem to, let's say, Gmail-like problem. And this is possible because we are using this technology that's compressed bitmap. So new advances in computer science that has been done in the past years for big data. Like I told you, we can aggregate data for operating system, DNS, name, HTTP, whatever. And you can see the aggregation, like I shown you before, through the web. It's nice to see, for instance, if you have an Ubuntu machine, that your system is talking with Mr. Ubuntu every so often. You can see also the activities that your PC is doing over time. You will see also, this is something I want to show you, the contacts. So in this map, HTML5, again, you will see hosts that are, the information that are related to the host itself, to the aggregation. So my host has contacted samuel.ntop.org, and these are other hosts with whom my PC has received data. And if you want, you can click on one of those, and you can expand it, you can move it, you can do whatever you want. There is the geomap. I told you that we have geolocalization. So you can see those maps are animated. You see this icon that is moving. OK, this was related to my home network. But you can see host per host, IP per IP, where your traffic is going. And it's using HTML localization. So this map is centered now to Nuremberg, if I show you, because I use the HTML5 geolocalization. So your map is centered to the right place. You will see host activities. You will see, for instance, over time, how your local host, what type of traffic are doing. You will see these almost constant activities. You see very seldom activities, just to understand not only the counter, but also how they look over time. And you can do comparison, because with the compressed bitmap, you can say, at this second, who was doing this type of traffic? You can do this in real time very easily. So we are storing traffic in disk in RRD every 5 minutes, but the resolution in memory is 1 second, so you can read data every second. As you can see, this is not the RRD, you know. So we use RRD only as a backend. I want to drop RRD at some point because RRD is efficient, but is not as efficient as I would like. So I want to do more. So you can move your cursor here. You can see. So let's look at the interface. You look at the interface. It says historical activities. You see, you can move here. It's dynamic. That's why I don't like the standard RRD. Question? Oh, sorry. Yes, this is true, but you see, RRD, like the original NTOP was designed many years ago, so they tried to push features in, but from a point of view, at least this is my impression, that we have to start over. So, yeah, but I will look at the RRD code. So, yeah, so that's the problem. It's not multi-threaded, you have to put... Yeah, I just have one more minute. I told you that you can export the data whenever you want, so you can read and you can see ntop as a live data source data. You have a clickable map, like a tree map. You see in this map, you see this area is larger, so it means this has done most of the traffic. This is a little traffic. So you want, if you want to look at the bird's eye, who is doing what, you just look at this map and say, oh, this is the main source of problem. You can, of course, read data from to and NetFlow or SFlow. This is not a problem. And the last thing we are doing, that this is the next step, so toward the future. Years ago, we started with the integration on a small power PC-based device, and it was as small as this. So we are now going back to the original idea. So we have just put ntopng into this this small. This is this is a small device that cost €36. I bought it last week from Conrad. So BeagleBone Black. So you can use ntopng inside this box. It's after the release 1.1 that we'll be releasing next week, we want to optimize it for the cloud. So I want to put devices here and there, and they have to report everything to a central location. You can see in your distributed system what is happening with a device that is cost less than €40. That's all, basically. I wanted to tell you a story today. So it's 15 years we are working at that. I don't want to introduce you a tool, okay? I want to tell you why we are here, why we decide to make certain choices, what mistakes we have made, and we hope what solution we have came from. And this is, everything is available, GPL v3, and this is the website. Thank you.
Well, I'm very impressed. I didn't even realize all the new things you did on last time. Great, fantastic. Do you have any questions? We have very short time, but if there are any.
You talked a lot about monitoring of one host, and this ntopng is, it's focused on the local host you are running your ntopng on? Ah, it's going. How about if you have 100 hosts in one network and you want to connect the dots between the hosts, so you want to see who is talking to whom and this kind of analyzing?
Yeah. What you have to do here is that you have to use a network interface to whom here, so this is just one, where you are sending traffic to. So you have a span port, or you put a network tab. So in this case, if you are next to the gateway, or if you are in a specific location, you can send ntopng your traffic. Then you can analyze not only the traffic of your PC. This today is only for the PC because I'm alone, But yeah, this is perfectly possible. Most people are using for that, not just for one PC, of course.
Yes, I have two questions. We discussed this already on the mailing list because when I started with the beta versions, there were several protocols missing. So there were all of my network traffic, internal, SAP and Lotus nodes, everything was missing. So I tried this with the old configuration, like defining ports and so on. So sometimes it would be better to override the automatically configuration of your NDPI with a port maybe. If I know my traffic, then I can say port 3200 is SAP for sure. That would be nice.
So in the current configuration, you can say exactly that. You can say, let's say, port UDP 860, so it's a SCSI. Or you can say, if you say venere.com, it's the protocol Venere. That is not a protocol, but it's an aggregation. Or here you can associate several websites to one. So IP, sorry, port, and this. I hope this is what you're asking.
What's about, I'm doing this on my internal network, so we have a big MPLS network worldwide, and I want to have GeoIP for this. So can I define my own GeoIP database for, you know, yeah?
Yes, this is also possible. NTOP is using the standard GeoIP file, but some users that, you know, like you have a cloud or whatever base, yeah, you can extend it. And NTOP, when we read the GeoIP information, will display the right flag next week. Yes, it's possible.
Maybe I missed it, but will ntopng be available for Windows?
Yes, it's already available.
Okay, so if there are no more